It is very fortunate, and you must learn to realize as well as to appreciate that having applied the Buddha Dharma, that you are also trying to fulfill the very vision of your teacher, regardless of all the difficulties, hardship, not reversing from all the adverse condition, but again working hard with your determination to fulfill the very intention and determination of your teacher is a very fortunate and as well as very important to also work towards that. Needless to mention that as you all know that out of so many that Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche was one of the very first who came in the Western world to establish the Buddha Dharma. Because the Buddha Dharma was not familiar in such a country, the style of presenting needed to be changed. Through his skillful means that he presented the Buddha Dharma so well that after several years, as you all again know, that his all students becoming very familiar with the whole concept of Buddhism. That has helped so many that were so totally new to such a subject. We, as yourself, as a student, you must really work hard towards again continuing such, as well as feel very fortunate and grateful to such a master who has brought the Buddhism skillfully and established such in the heart of the new tradition or new culture.
Chojine, Tishiran, Nawatan, Sami Javis, Chojine, Rumishamana, Shandamana, Pene, and this Chuan, Chuan, Matse, Chu, Kachu, Nawatan, Zuya, Tikasore, Mune, Sandy, Sumbe, Kora, Ka,
you can imagine yourself how difficult it might be to take a new culture into a new nation or the tradition, and establishing that tradition into a sort of new culture very firmly, in making it very familiar with that particular tradition, is extremely difficult to imagine, let alone really do such. So Trungpa Rinpoche's possibility to bring Buddhism into a new culture was not only hard, but he's exceptionally skilled individual. And therefore, we must also understand or prove out of such that he is not an ordinary individual. Out of that, we can learn to respect that every work that he has done, every work that he has sort of started, has some outstanding nature or quality that an ordinary person may not really be able to fulfill such. Out of so many outstanding activities of the Trungpa Rinpoche, that his vision, again, another example is the project here in the Nova Scotia, which again is beyond an ordinary person's imagination, that his whole project or goal being to build an enlightened society of both the tradition as well as in the way that he has presented the Dharma at the beginning. So to fulfill such, to work towards that, again, becomes very essential as our or students' duty. Beginning point of the starting of the Nova Scotia, His Eminence says that having visited the Northern America a few couple times after His Holiness Yao Kamapa, that he talked to a few students of the Vidyadhara Trungpa Rinpoche, and the whole idea or the concept of the project of the Nova Scotia was beyond belief to them, and they felt that it was impossible. And it is very true, His Eminence said, that at that particular period, at that time, it seemed impossible to the ordinary mind. But again, the Nova Scotia project is not a project of the vision of an ordinary individual. It's a project of the vision of an extraordinary being.
그 말은 뭐지? 그래서 더 소수의 기호 다들의 파벌 바로 위려와 대답해서 대인공이요.
And therefore, we have to now understand the difference between an ordinary and extraordinary being, the vision. So, looking back at that moment and now, it's a tremendous development. So now it seems there's possibility. At that time, at the beginning, it sounds, as His Eminence says, it was impossible. Now it's very possible. Since it seemed to be very possible, a project that was began by extraordinary being, you must not again get discouraged but work toward completing that possibility of the vision of
the
So whatever you have completed of the project here in Nova Scotia, you have done extremely wonderful job, and still you must bear in your mind it's not the completion, so you must work harder again with a trust, a confidence to your Guru, to Maruche, and again complete the whole vision of the subject is that whatever project that you are involved in, all the vision of the Tsimba Rinpoche, whether it's a Shambhala project or that of the other project, whatever the name is given for the project, but you must always understand the essential purpose of those projects is really very much for the enlightenment of the Buddhahood, or the liberation of the enlightenment. So based on the enlightenment, all those projects of the Tsimba Rinpoche has developed, that's something you have to bear in your mind always. So therefore, in all the visions and projects of Tsimba Rinpoche, the basis of all is Buddhism or Buddha Dharma. So since the whole concept of the enlightened society is based on the state of one's mind, state of your mentality, the pureness, the impureness of your mind. Therefore, it is very important whichever project you're involved in, not separating that very vision of Dzogchen from completely from Buddhism, but realizing though the Buddhism is very much ground or the basis of all those foundations, then there is a sense of understanding the enlightened society. Again, that the reason why His Eminence says he has brought this subject out
is
it may not really apply this particular subject to here at all, but having traveled in some places, particularly of Dharmadhar to New York and other places, that His Eminence came to realize that there is a big gap, a separation between the Shambhala and that of the Buddhism. And of course, His Eminence understands that the advanced student of the Shambhala practitioner may not have that separation between Shambhala the old students and Shambhala and that of the Buddhism, but maybe the new one out of there not understanding completely seem to have a tremendous gap of division, separation between the whole Shambhala and Buddhism. So that is a very sad news which may not apply here at all. Just in case His Eminence is concerned about that separation, and so that's why he has to share
that. 나랑게 섬이야들아 내가 이만에 가르상 위에서나 내가 하나 양주를 담. 근데 담바산이 바티 근데 내가 샤발라를 타고 주제를 섬 위에서 타버렸어. 근데 이 나무산이 바티 주제 시라버렸어. 근데 그 성장인도 탑라 시라버 쓰는 성장이나 근데 탑 이나양 근데 탑 되게 가서 원래 양하고 같이 팬 토고 말해 탑 더블디 근데 샴발라 당 대다 근데 시라부 추디 근데 남부 산지비 추디 지금 탑 다시 하고 소유 주기 좋나 근데 원래 안에 가서 원래 다른 이제 소양이 뭐냐 무슨 나 테레사
Personally, His Eminence regarded the Shambhala training or the Shambhala practice as a skillful means and Buddhism as primordial wisdom. But you cannot do much without the wisdom, and without, again, you can't do much without the skillful means. So the union of the skillful means and primordial wisdom is very necessary. So it need to become almost inseparable, and based on that understanding, His Eminence believed that there is no really separation between the skillful means and wisdom, as well as the Shambhala practice and that of the Buddhism.
And then Matsu Vega, the Shambhala Mune,
particularly that
Shambhala
and particularly that written turning the wheel of Dharma of the Kala Chakra in the Shambhala realm. And, so there is a tremendous connection. It's not that there is no connection at all, but there is a connection between Dharma and Shambhala in general term as well.
What I'm saying is, you know, I think he didn't get it. Like I said, you know, like historically, you know, in Shambhala, you know, is the place where they practiced of the Kala Chakra Tantra, and Kala Chakra Tantra is the one of the highest tantra in Buddhism. So there are always, you know, the connection between the Shambhala and the, you know, Shambhala practice and the Buddhist practice. So it's just a matter of, you know, it's how you look at. You know. So I'm sure that you have a Shambhala training practice is definitely a skillful means. But then if you say just by only that, you know, without the wisdom of the teachings of Buddha, you know, I don't think you can really develop enlightened society. You know. So it's very important to you know, to combine that. And then I think this is the oldest students responsible to do that. And as I've said just now, you know, like I've just, you know, noticed there's some conflict, you know, like in some Dhammadhatus. It may not be really the problem. That's just my concern. So I thought maybe there's some kind of, you know, tendency may arise, you know, problems, and which is, it could be, you know, kind of a confusion. You know. And so this is very important. I need to this to do.
Very strictly as an example to the world, so that with that example you are able to also inspire the people of the world, because with our inspiration that the sangha of the practitioner can grow. We are the very much, we have the responsibility for the growing of the sangha based upon our examples, and so we need to show a proper example of whatever within our capacity. And so on that particular technique that one really follow the path of the proper conduct or discipline. For example, that great master Nagarjuna has said that the sila, the moral conduct, is very much ground where all the knowledge, good quality, take birth. So whether you have a full ordination as a monk or nun, but the basic moral conduct of the body, speech, and mind requires to really develop spiritually oneself. So therefore, one must always try to maintain a strict disciplined moral conduct of one's own body, speech,
and mind.
Even in our worldly terms, in our regular life, some sense of the discipline for oneself requires to become quite effective in our job and develop a trust from other people or friends, and in that way, with the discipline, you become a reliable person. Without the discipline in our regular life, that if you do everything what you want and you are not maintaining any stability of life, that you are not a very reliable person in our regular or ordinary life either, so nobody can rely on such person. So not only that other people or your friend cannot trust you or rely on you, but you can't rely on yourself also if you go on in that sort of behavior. And since such behavior or discipline requires, even in the worldly activity, definitely in the Dharma activity, to accomplish something within the Dharma, discipline or Sila is very essential. So therefore, His Eminence respects and feels very pleased to know that people who are here maintaining the Vinaya discipline, whatever again they are capable of taking, and His Eminence hopes that you will also continue to maintain and preserve the very those who have taken the discipline of the Vinaya of the monk and nun, they will continue for the better of development for the future. And at the same time, those who have not taken such a discipline or vow, and lay people, householders, men and women, you must also learn to respect that and support and encourage them. Otherwise, again, it becomes very difficult. Those who have already taken to sort of further continue such, so His Eminence hope that you will all support that.
And
It must exist even in other different religions such as Christianity and so forth, but in regards to the lay or householder and that of the monk and nun, in the East or Tibet, that they are sort of interdependent to each other. The monk and nun needs the lay people, householder, and the householder, lay people needs the monk and nun. So they are very much interdependent, in other words, again, inseparable. And based on that, again, understanding that you are very much needing each other, it is, I mean, it's hoped that you will continue to support each other as well. Any questions?
Strange, or just it seems too much or too foreign, but the idea of, you know, basic goodness as opposed to Buddha nature as something they can relate to, and at first there's no real feeling that they have to and to take refuge in the Buddha Dharma, such that the Shambhala path could be that seems to be quite common in my experience with that. if that's part of what you're talking about, or if you could say something about it, because people seem to come in that way often, and then later on there's no difference because it's practice.
Since that Shambhala practice or training is being like a skillful means towards the introducing the Buddhism, for a beginner, maybe if they approach in that manner, not understanding about Buddhism completely, it seems to be quite okay. But as advanced students or older students, you must always make sure that in a final stage that they understand that there is no separation between the Shambhala and the Dharma.
I talked to Trungpa Rinpoche about the same thing you're discussing now. And he did say to a lot of us older students that Buddhism was the container for Shambhala training. So I've never really felt any confusion about it since he said that. I think when I was first new, the opposite, Shambhala training is the container for Buddhism. Uh-oh. But he never separated them, really, to me. So I think a lot of people try to hang on to... I've seen people come into Shambhala training and say they don't want to be Buddhist because they don't understand all this, you know, shrine and stuff like that. But also I've seen them after they practice a very long time, that usually they connect to the teacher's mind who presented all that, and he was a Buddhist. And I don't see that many people not at least becoming curious about Buddhism and feeling connected to it.
Yes, I'm there.
Yes, His Eminence understands that ultimately it cannot be really separated at all. But since that Buddha Dharma is not only as encompassing or that of pervaded within the as a in the Shambhala training, but Buddha Dharma or Dharma is pervaded in everywhere, in everything. Based on that, the whole problem really arises out of a sense of developing a fixation by individual beings. So it's not that it can be separated, but the fixation that they can develop could be the problem.
So you mean the people that are maybe in charge of teaching Shambhala training or running Shambhala training programs might not see the big picture, so to speak, that maybe they're presenting an improper situation. Okay, thank you.
Your minutes. Trungpa Rinpoche once said to us, we should be Shambhalian monks and nuns. What do you think he meant by that?
I think you are now.
What does it mean? What do you say that we are?
Slowly, when you sort of are able to fulfill the vision of Trungpa Rinpoche transforming this country into enlightened society, and within that, when you're monk and nun, you are the Shambhalian monk and nun. Any more questions?
Your Eminence, could you say something about the role of Gampo Abbey and monasticism in the Shambhala society and how it could develop in terms of benefiting all sentient beings in a bigger context?
Explained earlier that basically there is no really separation as and that of the Shambhala society or practice, and But again, that despite the fact that there is no difference, that all the Dhamma is based on the manner of the example that we display, or that the model for the future. So we have to have a proper sense of the example to benefit or to display example to the world for the future, in addition to, of course, our own individual practices.
So since the Shambhala, you know, the vision and then Buddha Dharma is ultimately no difference. Based on that, and then you know it is very important to have a you know the Buddhist teaching, and then essence of Buddhist teaching is of course individual practice and you know the study is teaching, but then also it's necessary there should be some kind of you know model of the you know representing of the real Dharma, you know. So that is the noble Sangha, and then since now Gampo Abbey seems to be the place for that, and so that's why it's very important in that area.
Rinpoche, I would like to ask if you could say something about how mandala and tradition and form that Trungpa Rinpoche has set up for us, how we can maintain the distinctness of that, and yet, as you know, my heart's wish is for really all of the Sangha, Karmakagyu, students of His Holiness Karmapa, to be closer together, that we could practice together more, or other students could come to Vajradhatu centers, or maybe go to seminary, or, you know, I want so much for us really to be more of large family together, and yet very much don't want to lose the brilliance and wisdom of the form that Trungpa Rinpoche has set up, which seems really quite distinct.
Well, I don't see any problems for that. And then especially when His Holiness comes, it will happen. You know, everybody will come together. And then you know, people practice together. But then at the same time, you know, we all, you know, always encourage people to maintain what Trungpa Rinpoche has, you know, shown, and you know, their especially way of practice, you know, people it presented. It's very skillful and very needful for you know this kind of for the students. So we all, you know, even we don't say this is Trungpa Rinpoche's style, you know. And then that doesn't mean this is not our style. You know, it's Trungpa Rinpoche is Kagyu teacher. And then in fact and so then we also encourage people to do the same, you know, people who need it. So I don't see that, you know, there will be any problems.
Is there anything you'd like to say about His Holiness?
Very soon.
We're on the same topic, well, close to that topic. Do you have any view on the possibility of the Trungpa Rinpoche rebirth? possibilities.
First is first. First is all in this case.
Nuns and the community of householders. Could you say something about the relationship between the abbey in this place and its immediate community? Red River, the people of Pleasant Bay, the people of Cape Breton. How does the community inside the abbey relate to those who are not practitioners of Shambhala or of Buddhism?
A person sort of having a foot in two worlds, one the ordinary life, two the study and practice of Buddha Dharma, is foolish to try to do that? Do you think that a person such as myself who's not a nun could attain enlightenment? Hampering myself needlessly by staying in the ordinary life.
Watch out.
Different people has a different, basically different karmic connections. So since every being has a Buddha nature potential, and so if you practice, definitely you can achieve liberation. But then of course, being nun and monks, it gets more chance to practice. Again, within the monks, nuns, there are a lot of people who doesn't do practice. It's very righteous. So please practice. Okay.
appropriate thing really is to do both, to do the rebirth suffocation and the longevity.
But we can, for tonight we'll just do longevity because we took the other time. Teach us for a long time. a long time until finally there's one day you come and